Susan, hi.
Hello, Alice. How are you?
I'm good. I'm good. I miss you.
Oh, boy. I miss you. I miss the whole gang. I miss the campus. It's really not something I've been able to get used to too easily, but at least we have Zoom, right?
Oh, I mean, thank God. I actually love it. Anyway, I'm just so glad you could be here. I knew you would be perfect for this in so many ways, and it's a refreshing angle to take for Women's History Month. So as I said, we're doing a series of interviews to celebrate Women's History Month. I would like to talk to you today about your perspective in terms of trailblazing women in the performing arts, and your own experience and some of the things that QPAC has been involved with, including your virtual programs. I read an article that said, you know, these are the most admired trailblazing women in the performing arts, particularly specifically because of Women's History Month. So I thought these artists were very interesting. I just wanted to run them by you and get your reaction. And maybe you could tell me a favorite or two and why. So we have Whitney Houston, Mariah Carey, Beyonce, of course, Dixie Chicks, Madonna, Ella Fitzgerald, Aretha Franklin, Dolly Parton, Lady Gaga. So what's your reaction? I mean, what's your emotional reaction? You know, what do you think in terms of your own taste and, you know?
Most of the women that you mentioned, they're more than just performers. They're a brand. They're entrepreneurs. They've been able to constantly, certainly, if you're talking about Madonna, for example, she has been able to reinvent herself a million times. Of course, Dolly Parton is a brand. She, of course, has her huge amusement park, and she's been financing entertainment and also all sorts of other projects throughout her career. So these women, they're more than just they're performers for sure, but they are they're more than just that. They are their own brand, and they've set the bar very high for themselves and for other performers.
Do you think that that applies to Ella Fitzgerald and Aretha Franklin? In terms of going beyond just being the performing artist, but also creating a brand?
Absolutely. Not only did they create a brand, but they also, Ella Fitzgerald, she broke barriers. Aretha Franklin too. Aretha Franklin brought her own style and take on music. And she brought it forth. She brought it to the public. Ella Fitzgerald broke a million barriers in terms of what she sang and where she performed. Mm-hmm. So they are absolutely trailblazers. I'll tell you a little bit. I'll give you an example of Ella Fitzgerald. I mean, there was no challenge too great for Ella. And I'll give you an example of that. There is a Yiddish song, an old Yiddish song called By Mir Bist Du Shein. And By Mir Bist Du Shein was written by an individual whose name is Sholem Secunda. And he wrote the song in Yiddish. And it's a very interesting story behind it, because the first time the song premiered, he was writing for the Yiddish theater. And so he wrote this song by Mir Bist Du Shein. It premiered at the Apollo Theater. And two of the performers there, John and George, they were performers up in the Catskill Mountains. And they learned this song in Yiddish while performing there. These were two African-American performers. And Sammy Kahn was in the audience that night, and he loved the song so much that he decided the song would have to have English lyrics. He wrote the English lyrics for that song, and it became a number one hit for the Greek Andrew sisters. It's really a story about all different cultures coming together through this song. But the reason why I bring it up is because Ella had a big hit with Baymir Bistushane. So there was no, and she sings the song partly in English and partly in Yiddish, but there was no challenge too great for her.
That's a fascinating fact. Now, one of the women that was not included in this list, and it just occurred to me, is Billie Holiday. I was looking back at some of the female performers who have appeared at QPAC mm-hmm. over the years. There was Judy Carmichael and Bernadette Peters, Melissa Manchester, Rita Moreno. Can you think of other female
Yes, actually, in anticipation of this interview, I went back through my mind. You know, Alice, I'm with Queensborough now for 17 years. Mm. And so we've had 17 years of extraordinary performers and storytellers and barrier breakers, Bernadette Peters, Patti LuPone, Vanessa Williams, Rita Moreno, Cheetah Rivera, Renee Taylor, Betty Buckley, Lady Kazan, Joan Rivers, Connie Stevens, Lucy Arnaz, Taylor Dane, Marilyn McCoo. I could go on and on. What a joy to have had each of these extraordinary women perform for us at Queensborough, and for each of them to tell their stories.
But the trailblazers they continue through the years and the decades.
They really do. And you know, it's interesting. In some cases, I was surprised that we were even able to get some of these artists. But they're on a mission. They're on a mission to tell their stories and to be seen and to advance the image of women in the entertainment business. And so there were some performers who I thought we might not be able to get because perhaps we weren't the number one entertainment venue on their list, but they came through. They came through. And each of them, it was so interesting. For example, Joan Rivers, if you saw her documentary that came out a few years before she passed, she talks about, if she wasn't working, then that day was wasted. You know, she wanted to be working all the time. She hardly ever refused a job. And she came in to the center. She was there early. She really took responsibility for her performance. You know, she mm-hmm. didn't expect us to just give her everything on a silver platter. She wanted to put in the work. Mm-hmm. And so there was a lot of things that went on sort of behind the scenes just to get, just for her to feel comfortable enough in the space so that she could give the best performance she could give. And she knew that. So she really took the time to make sure that things were set up in such a way so that she knew she would not be disappointing, the people who were there to see her. It was really incredible. In fact, I remember, I thought it was so intriguing that on her rider, you know, every artist comes with a rider and these are things that they must have. And on her rider, it said she needed an oxygen tank. And I thought to myself, well, that's odd. And I wonder why. And then, of course, I was in touch with her and she said, no, it's you don't have to get it. I'll be fine. But as it turns out, we had a conversation about it later at the theater. And, you know, she's on. She never looked at her watch once. You know, so if mm-hmm. we wanted her to do 90 minutes, for example, an hour and a half, you know, she was probably on for 2.5 hours, mm-hmm. probably, maybe even longer than that. And it was, you know, her, just her. And she would talk, you know, how Joan Rivers used to talk. She would talk so quickly and she got so much out so quickly. Well, anyway, the oxygen, it wasn't because she was ill, but when she was done with a set, you know, she had utilized so much energy. She wears these high heels and she walked up and back and up and back. And it was joke after joke after story. And it was 2.5 hours of that. And so there were times when she'd need to take sort of a hit of the oxygen just to sort of replenish her lungs, to get some, you know, fresh air into her lungs. So I'm just saying these are dedicated, serious performers.
With very solid work ethics.
That's right.
You must miss QPAC the way it was, and having those live performances there and working with people face to face. I'm wondering, I know that QPAC has undergone a lot of renovation in the past, couple of years?
Right.
And you must be anxious to get back.
We expect to reopen in the spring, this time next year, in the spring of 2022. Mm-hmm.
So tell me a little bit, I mean, you've had so much success with QPAC Live and other virtual programs. Talk a little bit about that.
You know, when this first happened, I didn't sleep because if you can't depend on the creatives, when something like this happens, who do you turn to? Who can you count on? If those of us in a creative field can't think out of the box, then what? So in a mm-hmm. sense, we really had to lead by example. And so I spent night after night thinking about what would be manageable. For example, here we are in my studio, which is mm-hmm. really my apartment. But I knew that I had to figure out how I could go live and then bring entertainers on with me. And so if you look back at some of the early broadcasts, it was really bare bones. I don't have all this stuff around, and neither do the performers. But it's really bare bones. But what's interesting is that we've figured it out, I've figured it out, and they've figured it out. And in fact, we've become now sort of a resource for performers who want to do virtual entertaining. They will call me and they will say, what do I need? And I'll tell them, well, you need this kind of a microphone and this kind of a, you know, backdrop and so forth. And so if you watch the progression of our QPAC Live programs, which is a broadcast that we go live with every single week, and we have been now for just about a year, what we've been able to accomplish. And some of the more recent programs are pretty good. Again, you know, we recognize that we're not in the theater, but at least we're keeping the music playing. And that's what's so important, because I also realized that during this time, I wasn't listening to any music. And I'm not sure if others were, but things had become just so quiet. It became quiet outside, obviously, because people weren't going out. Inside, we weren't, you know, we're not seeing people. Good morning, how are you? You know, you talk about being on campus. Maybe there were 20 people we would stop and say hello to. Good morning, how are you? All of that just stopped. And quite frankly, for me, the silence was deafening. It really was. And so we recognize that we're not in the theater, but we at least can provide, can offer something to our, you know, to our people.
Yeah, I went back and watched a recent QPTV interview you had with Ross Chast, and you echoed a lot of what you're saying now. And you talked about, you know, we have to remain optimistic and we have to learn to adapt to this new format because we don't know how long we're going to be in this situation. And I thought that was a very powerful point that you made.
You know, listen, we always look right. The glass is always half full. But we've been able to, there are a lot of new people that we're reaching this way. You know, most of the people who come to the theater are local folk. Mm-hmm. But the folks that turn on, and it's interesting, like anything else, it takes time to build an audience. And so when we went live virtually, we knew that it would take time, and it really did. But now we have our regulars. We have folks who, you know, on a Friday night or tonight, for example, we do Name That Tune, which is a great program. And we have our regulars. I can see who tunes in, and you know, we were able to interact. Now that's another thing. At the theater, the show starts and everybody's got to be quiet, and until intermission. But here, when we do these virtual broadcasts, you're able to interact both with me and the performers just by typing in your comments right below the broadcast. And so being able to interact with our, with the customers and our viewers, that's been kind of fun because they're able to, you know, right then and there, I love this, or what's the name of that song that so-and-so is singing? And so there's an element of something different that we don't have at the theater. And that's okay. And Alice, you know, you mentioned QPTV. That was something else that we thought about for a while, and we knew it was something we had to sort of configure into this whole virtual scenario. There are, of course, a number of people who don't engage via the computer, right? So how do we reach them? And so I did work. QPTV was wonderful. I worked with them to obtain what they call producer credentials. And that's enabled me to submit some of our programming to QPTV so that folks who don't use the computer can watch these programs at home. And so that's really been very gratifying because I know that at least the folks in Queens can you know, look at the schedule, see when we're airing one of these programs, and see what we're doing. Each of the programs that we submit usually play anywhere from 2 to 4 times in a given month. And mm-hmm. So it enables, you know, you could tune in. There are some morning time slots, some evening time slots. But I know that we're reaching more people that way. And that's the key.
I know you yourself have had a very successful singing career. I'd love to hear a little bit more than that. You've performed in a lot of different venues. And of course, you have many singing styles that you've mastered.
I have a wonderful perspective to be doing what I do now because, yes, there was a period of time when I, you know, I did more performing. And now, of course, my work is behind the scenes. And I must tell you, it is equally as gratifying, because it's just, it's about making an impact on someone and on someone's life. And whether I'm the one out there, raising hell, or whether I'm pulling the strings behind the scenes. But yes, I did do a lot of performing. I'm actually I'm also a cantor at various times. During this pandemic, I sort of went back to those roots that I used to call on. And that, interestingly enough, just looking at that material and sort of singing it around the house, if you will, I found to be very, very helpful in getting through this pandemic. But yes, I did. There was a period of time when I was singing the national anthem at Shea Stadium. And I remember, I did it for all sorts of reasons. I'm a patriot, and also it was something that I wanted to have on my resume. But when the time came, and it's really quite enormous, the whole thing, the whole process leading up to, singing the anthem is quite something. You're with the ball players. I mean, you're behind the scenes waiting to go on. And then I'll say, Miss Agin, are you ready? Yes, come with me. And you would, sort of wait there. And then you hear the announcement on the loudspeakers, right? And you hear, ladies and gentlemen, please rise and remove your hats. And I freaked out. I mean, that's huge, right? And then, of course, they say, and now singing our national anthem. I mean, talk about pressure. And I remember saying to myself, what am I, crazy? What am I, why am I doing this to myself? And then you walk out to the pitcher's mound, and there you are by yourself, looking at this huge stadium of people. But it was I got through it, and I ended up doing it again. And it was a huge honor. And I remember when I was finished, of course, the biggest thing is, you don't want to mess up the words. It's the national anthem. I mean, that's the pressure. And I used to always wear something with a pocket, and I would take the words on a little index card, and I'd put it in my pocket. And somehow, just having it, they always say, well, if you have it, then you don't need it. It's when you don't have a backup, that's when you forget the words, right? So it became sort of my lucky charm. As long as I had the words, the lyrics somewhere on my being, then I was able to get through it without any problems. But and it was a wonderful experience. And I remember, I'd run, and Shea Stadium had incredible feedback, a delay is what it was. So when you would start to sing, oh, say, can you see, you'd hear it back like 30 seconds later. It was easy to kind of get lost in that. So it was really, it was quite the challenge to stay on course, but it was a great thrill. And, I remember I'd finish singing and I'd run off the stage, and the ball players would give you a little thumbs up. So fun. It was really great fun.
What brought you into the theater to begin with? What was your early experience that just hooked you?
I grew up in a very musical household. Music in my house was just as important as education. that's it. You know, when you expose young people to the arts early on, it becomes part of their being. And I can't tell you how I've used those lessons in every aspect of my life. I mean, for example, if I didn't have some of that, you know, training, this would be a very awkward thing for me, you know. It's amazing how you take your life's experiences and apply them to whatever it is you're doing at that moment. And I find that all the time, that my experiences, both just being immersed as a young person, and also the training that I received as a young person, mm-hmm. that it most definitely prepared me for the various positions I've held, not just this one, but other positions where those skills really helped me, you know, develop my personality, my abilities, my business sense, all that. They all played a role. All that training played a role, and music, I mean, it was in my family, but it was my grandparents too. And mm-hmm. it was their great grandparents. In my house, it was as important as, you know, as our education was.
So was it, primarily your father? Was it your mom too? Your siblings?
It was really both of them. My mother was a dancer. She had her own dance studio for a while. And she also, I mean, she loved music. She could, you know, sing just about any song. And my father, too, comes from an extremely musical family. He's one of six children, and everyone played a different instrument. So you could only imagine, you know, what that house was like. You know, it was somebody was constantly practicing, or, you know, there was a lot of noise in that house. And, you know, I remember stories. I remember my grandfather telling a story that one time he came home, you know, and of course at that time they didn't have much. They were very hard workers, but again, music was like air to them. Really, that's the only way I can describe it. And he came home one day, and there were a whole bunch of strangers in their apartment, and my grandmother was sitting at the piano, and my grandfather walked in, and, you know, he kind of was like, what's going on in here? And my grandmother was just like, aren't they fabulous? It's a new group. You know, they're a new group, and I'm going to help them. I'm going to help them. I'm going to manage them, you know. And, you know, okay. I mean, there were so many kids in my father's house to begin with. A few more didn't really make a difference.
You mentioned once that your sister's daughter, it goes around the house singing. So it seems to be passing down through the generations.
My sister used to, I have two sisters, but one sister used to tease me all the time, because I would sing all the time, which I'm sure could get annoying, right? But I would sing all the time. If I was upstairs doing, you know, doing some kind of a chore, I was singing about it. You know, this is the way I do my laundry, or whatever it was. And it would drive her crazy. And she'd walk around, she'd go, just stop it, stop it. Someone get her to stop, you know? And I used to hate that, but she was always telling me to stop. And all I wanted to do was just keep on singing. And so when she had a daughter, she had a mini me. She had a mini me. And my niece goes around, and she has a fabulous voice, but she goes around singing all the time. And of course, you know, me being who I am, I would, you know, since from the time she was a baby, I mean, we used to walk, take our walks, and we'd sing, you know, hand in hand in that song, wherever we go, you know, that song, wherever we go, whatever we do, we're going to go through it together. You know, I think she was 3 years old when I taught her that song, and we'd sing it together. Anyway, but I would always encourage, I'd say, sing out, because the more she would sing, the more my sister, it would drive my sister. I said, it's payback. And so indeed, those things do sort of, you know, they get carried through the genes. What can I tell you?
You went to Queens College. Did you major in theater?
It was a minor.
So did you perform in any musicals when you were in school?
I did. Queens College at that time, had a fabulous theater program. Mm-hmm. And a number of the teachers there were also Broadway directors. And in fact, many of the students who graduated around the time I graduated were able to make the arts their career, which is really interesting. We have exceptional lighting designers that came out of that group, and composers and mm-hmm. performers. For example, I graduated with Danny Burstein, mm-hmm. and Danny is... My goodness, he's been nominated for a Tony. He was starring in Moulin Rouge right before the pandemic.
Wow.
So Danny and I, when I went to school there, that particular group was very determined. And I would say that, the majority of us were able to find careers in the arts, which is really wonderful because you know how competitive that field is.
Oh, yeah.
And heartbreaking. It's 24 hours. I don't clock out at 5:00 on a Friday. That's when my day begins, you know. We work weekends. We cater to so many people, the producers, the artists, the customers. It is exhausting. And, you know, there's plenty of times that those of us behind the scenes, we're brought to tears, you know, but then you get to see the magic. And that is the most wonderful, natural, emotional boost,
of course,
that anyone could receive. So that's where it's at.
And of course, reaching young people, especially during this time, is just crucial, right?
It's so crucial. We've been able to go remote also. We're not just entertainment, but we train a lot of young people. We offer all sorts of cultural programs, after school, weekends. We serve all different groups and ages and so forth. And oh my God. And what's interesting is that you can never be ready for some of the things. I don't know what it is about the arts, but it allows people to open up. Mm-hmm. And so we get involved in people's lives, and they keep coming back because we're offering them hope and inspiration. And it's really crazy. So just the other day, for example, We were running our weekly dance workshop for our own students, for the QCC students. And I got an email from a student, a gal, who said to me, I look forward to joining this workshop tomorrow. I'm feeling a little nervous. I've never really danced, and I'm a bit overweight. It was just so interesting that she felt she had to come clean, in a sense, you know? And it was so wonderful to be able to you know, to
reassure her.
Reassure her and to say, hey, I'm a bit overweight, you know. So that's not going to be an issue at all. And in this particular, on this particular medium, you could shut off your camera if you want to, you know. So I said, listen, you could shut off your camera if you want to, but I have to tell you that none of us are perfect. None of us are professionals. We're just there. You know, I want to applaud you, because what you're doing is you're in a sense jumpstarting a healthy regimen. You want to get moving. We're doing that. We're going to do it together. And she showed up, and, you know, she had a breakthrough. What can I tell you?
And it's been wonderful talking with you, Susan. It really has been so wonderful to learn so much about your own career and all of the things you're doing for the college, for the community.
We have the most incredible students ever. I just want to touch base. You know, we work with the students. We provide, if you will, a learning laboratory for them. So we work with them in all different ways, and we work with all the different departments. We've been working for years with the business department, and we explore the business side of show business and so forth. And we've worked with the students that are studying a massage therapy, for example. I mean, I have so many stories. I'll never forget when we set up, I'm not kidding you, we set up about 30 massage tables backstage and in the lobby of the theater. And we were hosting a performance by Moscow Ballet Company. And you know, these, I mean, we have so many stories, and these dancers, they travel on the bus and they go from place to place, and every day they're performing at a different venue. And it's just incredible. Their bodies are, you know, you can only imagine the kind of training they go through, and then the stamina they have to have, because, and I remember that what we did was we offered them massages before they had to perform, just to work through their muscles. Their muscles were so stiff and so forth. They're sitting on that bus. And I remember the prima ballerina. I remember one of our students working on her, and the student asked her, where does it hurt? And she said, everywhere. Oh. We just finished a 3-part student film festival, which was extraordinary. These students directed, performed in their own films, utilizing just what was available to them in their homes. These pieces were so exceptional and so moving. I am so thrilled that we had a chance to speak to these students and to show and to premiere their pieces. We have coming up, for example, 7 of our English classes, 7 of our English professors are teaching Ibsen's A Doll's House. Oh. And we've been able to put together a professional company of actors who are going to perform a virtual reading of the show for these students who are studying A Doll's House. That's coming up in April.
Thank you, Susan, so much.
Thank you for letting me share some of these fabulous stories. Thanks again.